This week on WealthTrack, why top strategist Richard Bernstein says investors are looking for risk in all the wrong places. What could hurt you the most is next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Clearbridge Investments, a Legg Mason company, Thornburg Investment Management, active management, flexible perspective. Ku and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences, and the Fairholme Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. What is the biggest risk in the markets today? Most investors would say the longevity of the bull market and the elevated prices of stocks. The U.S. stock market hasn't had a bear market correction of 20% or more since its March 2009 low, and stock prices are at the high end of their historic range. Just look at the Shiller P.E. ratio, the cyclically adjusted price-to-earnings ratio, also known as CAPE, that Nobel Prize-winning economist Robert Shiller created years ago to put the price-earnings level of the market into longer-term perspective. CAPE takes the current price of the S&P 500 and divides it by the average of inflation-adjusted S&P earnings over the previous 10 years in order to smooth out cyclical fluctuations in corporate profits. The CAPE at over 30 is at the second highest level since it's been calculated starting in the late 1880s. It's higher than it was in 1929 before the market crashed, although it is considerably lower than its peak in the tech bubble in the late 1990s. Well, this week's guest says by focusing on the stock market, investors are missing where the real risks are. In a recent report, Looking for Risk in All the Wrong Places, strategist and investment advisor Richard Bernstein says by far the biggest risks are in the bond markets. Since inflation bottomed in June of 2016, investors have continued to pour money into bond funds and ETFs. Higher inflation caused by an accelerating economy has led to higher interest rates. As bonds adjust to higher interest rates, their prices decline. Well, that is exactly what has happened. As Bernstein points out, bonds are the only asset class in the U.S. that have experienced negative total return, that's with interest added, since inflation turned up. He predicts much worse results ahead. Richard Bernstein is chief executive and chief investment officer of Richard Bernstein Advisors, which he founded in 2009 and now oversees nearly $10 billion in assets. More than $6 billion is in its equity and multi-asset ETF strategies, available as separately managed accounts through financial advisors. Morningstar now ranks RBA among the 10 largest ETF managed portfolio strategists. RBA also manages mutual funds, including the flagship Eaton Vance Richard Bernstein All Asset Strategy Fund. Bernstein developed his top-down macro approach to investing using quantitative analysis as chief investment strategist at Merrill Lynch, where he was voted to the prestigious Institutional Investor All-America Research Team for 18 years and inducted into its Hall of Fame. I asked Bernstein why bonds are at risk for a significant bear market, but stocks are not.
I personally would say, I think the bond market today looks like technology stocks in 2000 or housing in 2006, 2007.
Oh my goodness.
I think that's the level of risk that we're actually talking about. And the reason why is that the economic environment is changing very dramatically, but bond investors have not changed their portfolios one bit. And when I say bond investors, I don't just mean individuals, pensions, endowments, foundations, across the board, the whole investor scale, people's portfolios are still oriented towards disinflation. The unfortunate thing is that inflation has been rising now for two and a half years. Inflation expectations are going up, but yet still nobody is repositioning their portfolios. Bear markets usually occur when fundamentals begin to deteriorate and nobody cares.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is what's going on in the bond market right now.
So interesting. So even though, you know, I mean, we're looking at the numbers and we're looking at Sure, inflation is going up, but it's still quite low. I mean, interest rates are still quite low. We've got sovereign debt out there that's still at negative interest rates. So, you know, for a lot of us, we're saying, well, kind of where's the excess?
Well, I think, you know, the excesses are there. They're just not so obvious because it's not like technology stocks, you know, getting in the headlines. It's not like housing in the headlines. And, you know, the bond market's usually kind of much more boring compared to other markets and doesn't get the same amount of attention. But, you know, it doesn't matter what the absolute level of inflation is. You know, markets don't care about the absolutes of good or bad. Markets care about better or worse. And you've already seen that in bond returns. So I mentioned inflation expectations troughed about two and a half years ago. Since that trough in June of 2016, stocks are up roughly 45% since that period. Commodities are up roughly 15 to 20%, and bonds have provided a negative total return.
Wow, total return, that's with interest added in, yeah.
Exactly. So if you think about, we're talking more than 45 percentage points of lost return, and nobody cares.
Right.
That's incredible to me.
I mean, that should be a headline, and you're making it a headline.
I'm trying.
To your clients. Yeah,
I'm trying.
So your flagship ETF strategy, and it's a mouthful, Rich. It's the Richard Bernstein Global Risk Balanced Moderate ETF Strategy. has an allocation of anywhere from 20 to 70% in fixed income. So where are you? What's your position?
Right now, we're about 20 to 25%, depending on whether you include cash or not. We're at about as low as we can go in terms of our fixed income weight.
Right.
But more importantly, we also have very, very short maturities, very, very short duration, meaning the amount of interest rate sensitivity, very little interest rate sensitivity in our bond portfolio. We're right now about 25 to 30% of benchmark duration. Obviously, every portfolio has a benchmark. For the fixed income side, you can measure the interest rate sensitivity of your benchmark. That would be the duration.
Right.
We're only about 25% of benchmark duration right now. The studies show that the consensus right now is about 90 to 95% of benchmark duration. So we are incredibly short duration relative to most bond managers.
And you do ETFs.
Yes.
So these are very short-term fixed income ETFs.
Correct.
What does that position do for that portfolio? What role does it play?
So, look, I think if we could, we might be at zero in fixed income.
Yeah.
But there's different guidelines. We have many different portfolios. Each one has its own set of guardrails about how much risk you can take.
Right.
And we can't go to zero in terms of fixed income. But I think if we had the ability, we might actually do that.
And so for the individual investors who can make that choice to go to zero, what's your advice to them?
Generally, when people hear somebody like me speak, they say, oh, well, we have to get rid of everything. And that's silly. I mean, to say that you're going to get rid of all your bonds, get rid of, say, you're going to get rid of all your income-oriented investments, that's silly. I don't think that's a prudent way to look at to invest and to think about investing. Rather, what the message that I think and what my firm is trying to get out to our investors is that we want to have something in the portfolio that is going to work in a period of rising inflation, that's sort of anti-income. Right. If you think about diversification, the whole point of diversification is to have something that's in the portfolio in case you're wrong. Well, if you're an income investor, that means having something in the portfolio that's anti-income. Well, what's anti-income? It would be things like, you know, commodities, pro-inflation sectors of the stock market, all these different things that I think you'd want to put into a portfolio that the data show people are pretty underweight or ignoring completely.
Before we go to these specific strategies that you're employing, you know, for you were early number one in believing in this bull market, and you were early in believing that the bull market would be best in U.S. stocks. And you have always told us that this is the least believed bull market, in history.
Yeah.
Number one, are more people believing in it now, and why has it been the least believed bull market in history?
It's let's take the second part first.
Right.
Why is it the least loved bull market of all time? I think 2008 generationally scarred investors. It was such a horrible period in people's portfolios that and people were such risk takers that the needle has swung 180 degrees and now they're completely risk averse. And they believe that if they invest for income as opposed to investing for capital appreciation, they're not taking risk in their portfolio.
Right.
forgetting, of course, that if everybody believes that something is riskless, it becomes exceptionally risky. And that's, I think, where we've gone. We've gone from 2000, when nobody wanted dividends. If you think about during the tech bubble, nobody wanted those stinking dividends,
right?
Because they
wanted
showed
growth.
Yeah, we want growth and everything. And
right.
Now we've come 180 degrees and nobody wants any growth. They just want income. So I just think that needle has to be turned back a little bit and think about what is growth going to look like over the next 3, 5, 7, 9 years, whatever period you want to look at, and how do you include something in the portfolio that will take advantage of that?
Is it too late to be a believer?
No, I think that certainly it's not March of 09 anymore, right? Where people are not under their desks in the fetal position. That's clearly the best time to invest.
And the market's sure at a very different level as
exactly.
well.
Exactly.
Right.
I mean, we're 9 years into a bull market, almost 10 years into the
right.
bull market. So we have to put this in proper context. We don't want to get too drunk on this notion of getting bullish. Although we are in a late cycle environment, which is very normal in an economic cycle, it is not late in the cycle, which kind of leads people to believe that the abyss is minutes away.
Right.
So
now, when you say late cycle, I'm thinking, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that's an incorrect way to think about
right.
it. I think that late cycle environments can go on for a long period of
mm-hmm.
time. Most importantly, the factors that we would look for to signal to us that a bear market is on the horizon, they're nowhere to be seen.
Mm-hmm.
And things like deteriorating corporate profits is a prime thing that tells you that the bear market is coming. Corporate profits in the United States are still accelerating. They're still extraordinarily healthy. So I think that in and of itself is kind of a hint that the abyss is not minutes away.
Give us the growth story. How have things changed?
Right. I think when you talk about a growth story in the general economy, I think we have to make a subtle but a very important distinction. Are we talking about real economic growth or nominal economic growth?
Right.
Real growth is what everybody hears.
Before inflation.
Yeah, before inflation. Nominal growth is real growth plus
inflation. Mm-hmm.
And I think that the story going forward is going to be about nominal growth, not real growth.
And why is that important? Why does that matter so much?
It matters just simply, if you think about a very simplistic point of view, nominal growth is important because it implies that there's going to be more pricing power in the economy. If there's more pricing power in the economy, corporate profits can actually expand simply by raising prices. Now, to an economist, that's not real growth, but to a stock market investor, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Profits can be made by either the number of units that you sell or your price per unit. And if your price per unit's going up and I can still sell it, that's called profits. Pricing power is coming back. I'm sure most people are beginning to see this. If you go out and start buying things, you can see prices going up. And I think that's going to be a big fill up to corporate profits as we go through, the end of 18 into 2019.
Right. Everybody kind of focuses on on the problems and the risks. And certainly
mm-hmm.
when you're looking at corporate profits, people are talking about, barriers.
Mm.
Tariffs are a tax on corporations and individuals.
Absolutely.
Talk about, some of the risks and how much of a problem that they present to a growth story.
Yeah, well, certainly your worst case scenario, if we take a decision tree and we go down the bad side of the decision tree every single time, yes, the stock market's going to go down with respect to tariffs. But I think what people are missing here, just in general, and again,
mm-hmm.
let's get back to the fixed income notion for a second, that public policy right now, again, not passing judgment whether this is right or wrong,
right.
I'm just saying public policy is very pro-inflation right now,
mm-hmm.
uniformly pro-inflation. And
tax cuts, fiscal stimulus.
On an already strong economy.
Right,
that's
right.
The thing that people don't understand. Very unusual to see tax cuts in the ninth year of an economic cycle, to see fiscal spending. I mean, government spending's up about 7-8%
right.
year on year in a late cycle environment.
Right, that usually happens in recessions.
Exactly.
So that's inflationary, right?
It is.
Typically, that's been very inflationary.
And it's, in this time, the reason it's so
right.
important is because we're already stretching the limits of the U.S. economy. You see this in terms of delays in getting products. If you put in a commercial order right now, the lag times between the order and delivery are the longest virtually in history.
Really?
Yeah. The product markets are very, very tight right now. Labor markets, first time in my professional career, perhaps in my life, there are more job openings than there are job seekers. The labor markets are very tight. And the product markets are very tight. That's normal for a late cycle environment.
Mm-hmm.
This is, but it's now being exacerbated by the tax cuts and the fiscal spending on top of that. And so, you know, you're not going to alleviate the product problems and the labor market problems by stimulating the economy. Then you'd say, well, what else is going on? Well, again, not passing judgment whether it's right or wrong. I know these are all sensitive topics these days, but if you think about whether it's tariffs, which by definition are inflationary, they're supposed to raise prices. Mm-hmm. You think about immigration mm-hmm. and not encouraging skilled workers to come into the United States. You think about
that means wages will go up for skilled. You're going to have to pay the skilled workers more.
Absolutely.
There will be fewer of them.
Absolutely.
Right.
It's just a scarcity of labor, like any other product. You think about Iran, and if we start putting sanctions on, well, we have put sanctions on Iranian oil. There's not enough spare capacity in the world to make up for Iranian oil being taken off the market. That would be inflationary. And you could just go on and on and on and on. Now, again, I understand why these are policies are put in place. I understand the goals. I understand everything else. I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
My job is to try to make money for my clients.
Right.
And the investment implication across the board here is that everything we're talking is pro-inflation.
Right. So this is a big change.
It is.
And
it's
of course,
a huge change.
You know, those of us who lived through very inflationary times,
right.
This is very worrisome to hear, but you're saying there's a positive to this. So we're not talking
right.
about stagflation.
No.
We're not talking about interest rates going up on a 30-year on, you know, to 15% or whatever it was in 1981.
No.
But nonetheless, that's going to be, that's the story going forward. So what do we invest in? What are
right.
pro-inflationary investments?
Right. So on the equity side, I think you want to look at sectors that benefit from rising prices. They would typically be things like the material stocks. They would be energy stocks. They'd be industrial stocks.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the three prime winners from a rising inflation environment.
And our viewers should know you don't invest in specific stocks.
Correct.
You are investing in sectors.
Correct.
So
that's exactly
therefore,
right.
I mean, I'm just looking at some of the sectors that you own in materials, the Vanguard Materials ETF, Industrials, Industrial Select, Spider Fund, Energy, Spider, S&P, Oil and Gas Exploration and Production ETF, at least these were in the portfolio
correct.
Recently. So that's how you're positioning yourself.
Correct, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
We are, you know, to use the standard term, we're very overweight
right.
energy, materials, industrials. I think that's kind of an easy way to think about it.
And commodities, I mean,
commodities themselves.
Those right. are hard to invest in. So, I mean,
they
you know.
Are. So, yes, we do invest in commodity ETFs. I think they're very good in a pro-inflation environment. I'm not one to give tax advice, but I think before investors actually look at some of these, they have to understand the tax implications
mm-hmm.
of what some of these ETFs mean or what it could mean for the investor. Even gold. I mean, gold has been kind of a blech investment.
It has.
For an extended period of time now. But if you really think, as I do, that inflation is going to be picking up, gold can help a portfolio.
Mm-hmm. And it's going to help a portfolio because you think that gold will finally appreciate?
Yeah, I think, look.
Because it hasn't
gold,
for the last several years.
Right. Gold's a very romantic investment. People
mm-hmm.
always ascribe some magical properties to gold. Gold is just another real asset.
Mm-hmm.
It's like any other commodity, really. And why do commodities go up? They usually go up because they're real assets, and real assets appreciate when inflation goes up. And when inflation goes down, you want to be in financial assets. When inflation goes up, you want to be in real assets. And so gold's just another real asset. I don't think there's anything sexier than that.
I'm looking at one of the ETFs that is one of your top ETFs. It's the Vanguard Information Technology ETF
mm-hmm.
in that balanced portfolio.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that? Why information technology?
We've been there for a long time.
Yeah.
This is not a new position for us. And I think when you talk about tech, there's always sort of two things people forget about tech. Number one is that technology is the most foreign exposed sector in the United States by far. Nothing else is even close.
Oh, interesting.
So mm-hmm. you'll find that tech tends to do reasonably well when the dollar's falling and tends to be under pressure when the dollar's appreciating. But the more important thing that everybody forgets about tech is it is a deep cyclical sector that is always mistaken for growth. There is nothing growthy about technology. It is a huge cyclical sector. This has always been true. It's still true. If you go back to the bear market in 2008, which was not a technology-induced bear market like 2000, right? The tech bubble in 2000, you know, with that bear market, tech stocks did very poorly. You go to 2008, that bear market was a financial sector, a housing-related bear market. The major tech stocks were down between 55 and 80%.
So even the FANGs, you don't do individual stocks, but even they're not immune to cycles either.
Not at all.
And right, if you think Facebook about and Google,
if you think about the industries that some of them are involved in, whether it be advertising or retail sales or whatever, since when is advertising and retail sales not a cyclical industry?
Right.
I mean,
right.
But yet people talk as though these companies are infallible, and that sort of should concern most people.
Emerging markets. You've got a position in emerging markets.
We do. We've been in emerging markets. Again, some emerging markets are very inflation-oriented,
right,
commodity-centric, things like that. They do very, very well. I would think that'd be kind of interesting. The other thing to remember is that emerging markets are just a play on global growth. These are, again, everybody talks about them as being growth stocks. They're really deep cyclicals. If you're reasonable bull on global growth, you'd want to have some emerging markets. If you're very wary about global growth, you'd want to lighten up.
Why aren't you worried about a stock market, a bear market in stocks?
I would say there's three factors that usually come before a bear market. Number one would be that corporate profits begin to deteriorate. That's clearly not happening now in the United States. I mean, we could argue whether that's good or bad, but the corporate sector is doing very, very well.
Right.
Number two, you'd want to see too much liquidity withdrawn by the central bank. What I mean by too much is every central bank is trying to slow down the rate of lending and everything in various economies. The Federal Reserve has started to tighten, as everybody knows.
Right.
It's not that they tighten that causes a bear market. It's that they tighten too much. How do you know when they tighten too much? The yield curve will invert. Short-term interest rates will be higher than long-term interest rates as the bond market begins to anticipate slower growth ahead. That's not happening. Number three, you'd find everybody would be bullish as all get out, and valuations would reflect that bullishness. There's no way that people are heady about equities in the United States.
It's just not happening. How threatening are the high levels of debt?
Yeah, there's two ways to think about this. Number one is corporate debt, and has the amount of corporate debt increased? Of course it has. I mean, interest rates have been low. We're 9 years into an expanding economy. Of course, debt levels should be higher. I think what you'll find, though, is that coverage ratios, how well their profitability can cover their interest payments, are still very, very healthy. The second thing I would point out about debt is that people have said for a long time that all our national debt, all the debt that we have, is going to ruin the country. And that's great drama. I love that. It's like all of a sudden we're going to wake up one morning and we're going to be like Botswana or something. You know, I mean, unfortunately, it's not the way it works. But when people can't figure out why we've had a secularly slower growth trend in the United States than we have historically, I would argue the answer is the debt that's hanging over that we have, because a lot of U.S. cash flow in total has to go to service the debt. It can't be used for investment. It can't be used to buy things. And so we're already experiencing the overhang of these big debt levels. It's just that nobody recognizes it.
One investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, what should we all own some of in a diversified long-term portfolio?
I think right now, as I said before, most people are very income-oriented. You want to look for the anti-income.
Right.
Right? It's like you have matter and antimatter. What's the antimatter to your portfolio here? I think it's something related to commodities. I think you'll find that most, especially individual investors, have very little exposure to commodities. Now, you could do that through energy stocks and material stocks. You could do it through a commodity ETF. There's a million different ways to do it, but I think that's the tack that you should have in a portfolio now. You want something in the portfolio in case I'm actually right. Right? If I'm wrong, you're pretty well protected. Most people are there already. But if I'm right, you want to have something in that portfolio to protect you.
All right. Great. Rich Bernstein, so great to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for joining us. At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is put some inflation beneficiaries in your portfolio. As Rich Bernstein points out, inflation pressures are building from a number of fronts: the growing economy, higher interest rates, tight labor force, increasing debt levels, and punitive trade policies. After a decade of dormant inflation, even seemingly small increases can have an impact. Protecting your purchasing power with investments that keep up with inflation, including companies with a history of rising dividends, can do that. One group mentioned frequently by WealthTrack guests is what is known as the dividend aristocrats, which are companies that have raised their dividends every year for 25 years or more. There are several ETFs built around companies with long histories of increasing dividends. The ProShares S&P 500 Dividend Aristocrats ETF, symbol NOBL, is the only ETF that specifically tracks the S&P Dividend Aristocrats with 25-year track records. The SPDR S&P Dividend ETF, symbol SDY, chooses companies from the S&P 1500 Composite Index with at least 20 years of dividend increases. Changing circumstances call for portfolio adjustments. Well, next week, financial thought leaders James Grant and Jason Zweig debate active versus passive investing and if Benjamin Graham's value approach has lost its value. To hear more of our interview with Rich Bernstein, please go to the extra feature on our website, WealthTrack.com, and keep reaching out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Clearbridge Investments, a Legg Mason company, Thornburg Investment Management, active management, flexible perspective, Ku and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences, and the Fairholme Foundation.